My name is Jonathan Bordo, and I'd like to introduce you to Roger Miller and Gunnar Olsson. And the three of us hope to engage in a discussion concerning our disciplines, and specifically the discipline of geography and its difficulties. I'll begin with myself just very briefly. I'm a philosopher who's been trained in the United States. Much of my work and early studying was directed toward giving me tools that would let me think about what I should call, if you want, generalities. I wanted to be able to think about the world in terms of fairly condensed pictures. And in going about doing that and developing those peculiar tools which philosophers have, which catch us between a text on the one side and logic on the other, I've found that having, I believe, begun to develop those tools and have a mastery of them, I find myself to some extent homeless in my profession, as if the discipline itself prevents me from thinking about things that I in fact want to think about, which have both general and, if you want, interdisciplinary import. And I found that over time that I take great pleasure and interest in talking with thinkers and people who in fact cross over from their disciplines, and I have found in that there's much that we share in common. I won't go on and say much more about it right now, but it's from the conversations that I've had with you, both of you, since we've met here in Lund, I've found it, on the one hand, quite surprising that the encounter could be so immediate, and then at the same time the difficulties of trying to sort out the differences in our approaches and our languages and the language games we use. Because I think that we meet at a frontier where each of the disciplines says you have to, in order to protect yourself, withdraw. And yet the propulsion in my own work has been to say I want to somehow continue and be able to extend that conversation, so it takes me, so it's less self-directed and more directed toward the world. Roger, did you?
Okay. I came to geography through a rather strange path, actually, having had absolutely no undergraduate geography, and in fact having gone through about 2.5 years of a graduate program in medieval English literature before taking my first geography course at the graduate level. And I found myself attracted to geography in a very odd way. I had gone into medieval English literature essentially because I was very dissatisfied with the world as I found it, and I was trying to remove myself from that world, I think. And I very rapidly became disenchanted with my choice and began to look for something that would provide more relevance, I think. A discipline that would allow me at the same time to maintain a Catholic set of interests, but at the same time allow me to apply knowledge to what I perceived as real pressing social problems. And for the first few years of my career in geography, I found myself quite taken with the possibilities that seemed to be offered. I was able to both continue my old interests in language and literature and forge new ones, particularly focusing on urbanism. And as I began to concentrate on a particular subject, the growth of suburbs and particularly how suburbanization affected women from the 19th to the 20th centuries, I found myself being pushed further and further toward the periphery of the discipline that I had chosen, precisely because it seemed to offer the widest range of possibilities for doing exactly what I wanted, perhaps being a dilettante at heart. But as I've pursued this topic of what happens to women, women's lives, household organization, in the ongoing process of suburbanization, I found myself having to seek further and further to push more and more to include anything that I could really consider spatial in the process. The questions that I began to ask that I found really interesting as I pursued this topic, having started from a very spatial position, were becoming more and more oriented towards social questions. And it was at that point that I began to really feel the limitations of the discipline, and in fact of all disciplines, because the questions that I had become interested in, the intrusion of the public sphere, of socialization processes, of propaganda, of ideology, into people's individual, private lives, the choices that they were offered for organizing those lives, didn't seem to fall within any discipline. It seemed to me to be an important question, yet one that was to some extent an orphan in terms of the traditional disciplinary framework within which academics organized their lives. And that has led me to a desire to participate in this discussion of the problems, both of the disciplinary approach to knowledge and problems involved with really socialization and social theory.
Well, I came into geography really by default. I came to the university. I was interested in history, political science, social science, literature in general. And I began to study geography because I needed that for the degree, and I wanted to get rid of it as quickly as possible. And on that road it still is. And I'm still trying to get done with it. When I began graduate work, which was actually in 1960, what was at the frontier then in the discipline was the quantitative theoretical approach. And I got very interested in that very early on. I got interested in it because I didn't understand it. And I had to work for about 10 years to begin to do that. But I was lucky from the beginning in the sense that I became interested in a subject matter that was at the center of social sciences themselves. That was human interaction, how we are tied together as individuals and how we are tied into large structures. And I wanted to study variations in that and explain them by reference to spatial variables, particularly distance. So what I did then was to write about human interaction and distance. What became clear during that more and more abstract, more and more theoretical work, was that I really did not get insights into human interaction per se, but what I got insights into was instead the spatial forms, the spatial prison within which we perform this human interaction. So in the process of the work, the deeper I got into it, the problem itself changed. This meant that I, in a sense, got straight into the fundamental problem of geography, which concerns relations between spatial form on the one hand and content or meaning on the other. This is a problem of inference, of how, when you see something, a thing, an object of some sort, that object is itself fused with meaning. It is, in a sense, revealing that meaning that has been what has been pushing me. And as I have done this, I have moved away from the spatial analysis of the 60s via a period of a lot of philosophy of science and philosophy concerning issues of identity and existence, into language issues, into theories of the text, into problems which are like this, that you can read, in a sense, the world around us, read ourselves as a text, as a book, And the questions then are, how do you interpret that text? Who wrote that text? How can we read it? What is the function of the signs themselves? We're again going back to Saussure and all these people who know that every sign has two sides, one visible, one invisible, one touchable, and one meaning. What has become more and more interesting to me is the relation between these two sides, the ontological transformations, if you will, that we perform whenever we try to understand a sign.
Well, I just wanted to go back to one comment you made. Mm-hmm. This is with respect to your reflecting upon the model. It seems to me one aspect of that is that we naively begin with the conviction that there's a glue that holds our, let me call it, our representations to reality. And then once one begins to discover that so much of the work of, well, all the different modes that we go about finding, of expression in the world, but most desperately in science, that we begin to suddenly realize that so much of our thinking concerns the conceptual apparatus on the other side of let X represent. Mm-hmm. So that and that the relationship between these representations and reality really doesn't have that kind of glue-like quality. It seems to me, would that kind of capture, it seems that you're like a primitive realist at the same time. One starts off, one has to be naively to begin to believe that what one's doing is telling the truth. One has to naively believe that what one's doing is about the world itself. One has to believe that. And so I'm picking up that one part of your reflection, your critical reflection, was just simply to begin to recognize that the activity was about, not about the world per se, but it was really about itself. And it was about itself in very important ways, for example, having to do with ways that one could, if one thought about the world in this way, one can intervene in the world in other ways.
Well, the issue is not about the world, the issue is about understanding the world. And not understanding the world for the world's sake, but for your own sake. So, I am quite convinced that in my case, studying the world, whatever that is merely a euphemism for studying myself. And when you do that, that has tremendous consequences in terms of your relations to the ideas, because it is no way that you can reject your previous ideas. So what you do is instead that the longer you hold an idea like this, the more you squeeze it like this, the more you try to press it to the limit in a kind of dialectical Hegelian fashion, it changes. But you never reject it. You transcend it. Dislike your parents. You cannot reject them. If you do, you have serious problems. They stop, perhaps. They do not repress you any longer, but you're always carrying them.
Yeah.
You, there are traces of this to use Derrida's vocabulary, whatever you do.
So let me just catch this. I have perhaps a way of relating it to a remark that was quite fugitive, which Roger made, and that is that it seems to me that one of the characteristics of science, of objective knowledge, is to, in fact, suppress self-reference. So it's one thing to talk about, for example, science, that we talk about the scientific model and the folk model. Now, one of the characteristics of our society is that we continually, in the way we view objective knowledge, is that the best way to view objective knowledge, in so much as it concerns us, it has an interest, is to view it as objective knowledge. And so what's suppressed is, if you want to go using, you brought up Hegel, what's suppressed is the recognition of self-consciousness. What we have is consciousness, in his terms, in Hegel's distinction. And so your prise de conscience with respect to the model. These models is really a reflection on the self-consciousness aspect of it, which has been suppressed in the activity. I'm just trying to capture that.
Yes, but this raises now fundamental issues about the structure of scientific knowledge. I think that you very meaningfully can say that the point of scientific knowledge is to, or the point of science is to produce new knowledge. But this knowledge cannot be of any type. It has to be very particular. It has to be of the type that it is cumulative. Now, that is the traditional view of it. And because of that requirement, the types of questions you ask and the types of approaches that you use are different. This, to me, is a fundamental reason why we, in our scientific search, focus so much on things and so little on relations. But this then has led into other consequences, and that is that we have been able to accumulate knowledge in some areas, like physics, chemistry, engineering, and so on. But it seems to me that in other areas, areas that concern us as social scientists and humanists, we have not been able to accumulate knowledge. This to me is a fundamental question to ask, how it comes that we have been able to accumulate knowledge in some areas, while in others we have not. Why do we in some areas know so much more than the Greeks did, in some others no? This to us is fundamental because we usually say that we are concerned with the areas where indeed we have not been able to accumulate.
And to some extent, the very success of those disciplines such as chemistry, physics, engineering, have allowed them to propose that their model, in fact, is not only superior because it's cumulative in its nature, but in fact, we have, in the social sciences, adopted that model to a large extent within the disciplines of the social sciences, in spite of the fact that the nature of the phenomena being studied are completely different. And that's led, I think, to some of the major social problems that we've seen ourselves being less and less able to confront.
It seems to me on this that, in fact, geography as a discipline is far more interesting than the other social sciences. I once, for example, did political science, because there's a very, very thin line between its quantitative concerns and the qualitative concerns. So the phenomenological type issues with respect to, say, time and distance continually demand on one side that one reintroduce the subject. And whereas if you look at other of the sciences, for example, let's say sociology or even history, I mean, the quantitative aspects of history are like concerning the demographic type consideration, long-term changes that take place over time, and then one has these other types of qualitative concerns, which can be quite easily separated off. I mean, this is how it is that someone like Ladurie could be first a quantitative historian, and then get involved in these structural reconstructions. Mm-hmm. But it seems that geography is a discipline. I say this as an outsider, is remarkable. Because from the outside, it seems it's just this universe of bric-a-brac and this collection of the most incredible bunch of things. But at the same time, the more I've thought about it, what's interesting about it is that it's got one connection, which where the quantitative and the qualitative are very close together, almost like Janus phase. This is a term that you've used. They're very, the self-consciousness question is constantly posed. It's always there. Whereas in the other social sciences, one could have adopted so readily the Newtonian, the search for a Galileo Newtonian model, because the activities were seen as being about basic structures governing, for example, macro things. I don't know.
I think when you want to account for that, you should remember that geography, internationally speaking, has always been a very small discipline, which means that it hasn't been as strongly institutionalized as, say, economics, sociology, or the physical sciences. And therefore, I think that geography has been much more open to very strong individuals. And it has been possible to do things heretic, searching very far out in geography that probably would not have been possible in some of the stronger disciplines. So while some people argue that we should have a focus, we should be very big, we should be very strong, if we were, I think that it would not be so natural that people like myself would feel comfortable within the discipline. So what is usually often taken to be a weakness, I take to be the real strength of the discipline. The discipline has not been strong enough to put someone like me down.
At the same time, I don't think that's for lack of trying. There seems to be an inordinate amount of the literature of geography which is really concerned with what is the core of the discipline, what is not within the core of the discipline. We seem to be much more concerned with what we are than perhaps historians, economists, certainly more than physicists or chemists are. And to some extent, our concern with ourselves as a discipline reflects the fact that, you know, as you put it, Jonathan, we are sort of a collection of bric-a-brac. I don't know that we have, in fact, any kind of unifying theme, which doesn't mean that we don't try to define such a theme, usually in very limited terms, and usually in such a way that we use our definitions of the discipline as a club to try to keep people in line who don't perhaps fit that definition. But by the very fact that we are so small and we have people with such diverse interests, in part because of the huge amount of things that we've sort of accepted as the domain of geography, from physical geography, climatology, to social theory, it's very hard, in fact, to come up with one core definition that everyone will accept. And so all such attempts, I think, have fortunately been foredoomed to failure, which perhaps is why the discipline is not large enough, not institutionalized enough to keep recalcitrant or young Turkish members in line.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have a naive question to ask you about this. Naive question is, how did geography lose its innocence? How did it begin to assume that the best way for it to encounter the world was for it to have a practice? When I think of the social sciences, I always look for administrators behind them, and that the way one's going to justify one's epistemic pursuits are that it really has a cash value in terms of this is what it does in the world. And it seems that it's not obvious to me right from the beginning. I know it's not obvious to many people about geography that geography has a practice, and the practice is planning.
Well,
how did that come?
I think that, in fact, the virgin was deflowered very early. In fact, in the 19th century, you know, much of what is today considered economic geography came out of commercial geography, as the powers of Europe and the Americas grew. They needed commercial information about new lands, new resources that could be exploited, and so forth. And commercial geography was a logical outgrowth. I mean, it was very instrumental in its concerns. In terms of physical geography, the association of people like Powell with the great geographic explorations, geographic and geological explorations, again, was extremely instrumental. They were out looking for resources to be utilized. So I think that, and even I think in the ancient world, I mean, there was a very clear concern with practical applications of the knowledge that was being developed in geography through the ages of exploration. So I think it's not a new situation. And if anything, the concerns in geography that have been less instrumental, I think, represent the innovation rather than the other way around.
Yes, yes, I would agree with that. There is a long military tradition in geography. You saw that the surveying, the expansion, moving into new lands and all that was, of course, one arm of the military. And it still is in the States now, particularly in the States. The only, perhaps the only part of geography that is expanding is at West Point. And that is not out of tradition.
I must ask you, it must be expanding with respect to outer space geography.
It is. Yes. Remote sensing, which geography has tried to make part of its own turf, is one of the fast-growing areas, and you know, a large number of geographers get jobs with the Defense Mapping Agency, providing skills for the computer, the digital maps that are used to guide cruise missiles and so forth, which slowly brings us to the point of the difference between instrumental and ethical approaches, I think, to a discipline or to social questions.
Well, I want to resist that for the moment, because I'd like to get a firmer sense of the scope of let me call it geographical interventions.
Right. Roger brings up the mapping, and the mapping, of course, is one of the central things in here, where what you do, what you had traditionally done and what you still do, is that you produce a map. That is a description, in a sense, of what the world looks like. Now, the point of the map is not the map itself, but of course the point is to use that as a beginning of an analysis. So you produce this form, which is a map. And then the next question is, what processes gave rise to that form? That means to me that it is here that the central geographic issue is, which is the relation between form and process. Now, this is the traditional inference problem. Question is whether indeed from a detailed knowledge of form you can say anything definite about processes that gave rise to that form. And since the work that several of us did in the late 60s, we know very well that this is not the case. So that in fact you can produce exactly the same spatial form through drastically different processes. Now, what does that mean? Well, to me it meant that this was a shot under the waterline of this ship of geography, an irreparable shot. So with that type of conclusion, which actually came in the late 60s, to me there is no real integrity left in geography. This is the inference problem. It's interesting to see what happened after this shot went through the ship. They are still repairing it, of course, but I think it's essentially irreparable.
Just an interjection. So this is kind of geography's uncertainty principle in the way it went about trying to
interpret it. In a sense, yes, yes. The uncertainty principle then is interesting also in the sense that you arrive at this result by using some fairly sophisticated probabilistic models to get this insight. Which then raises other questions which were also very central during the 60s, that is the relation between deterministic structures and probabilistic human action. which is a problematic that is still with us very much, for instance, in the new structuration theories, where the problem is how you and us, I as human free agents, can merge and can function within given structures, which in its turn leads into all these questions that some of us now are beginning to ask about socialization mechanisms. That is how we as individuals become so obedient to these large structures. That means that there are some very interesting epistemological connections between the form process problematic and the whole issue of power.
Well, that's a lot now. I have to digest all this. I have to figure out where would be the best way to. You've just introduced a new. We've just got a large agenda. We've had an agenda change here. This is good. And for me, my temptation here is to just want to ask you about structure, and ask you what it is to for us to. Well, not only to conceive a world structurally, but also to, in a structural way, but also to more and more treat human beings as agent supports of structures. It kind of seems to me there's a reflexive thing that goes on. But I won't do that. You've got me really confused. You're not going to be confused, I want to now see if we can sort out that agenda.
Mm-hmm.
So one topic that I would go about focusing your last commentary on would be, well, maybe we want to talk a bit about structure as being a center, but that might not be the only thing one wants to talk about, so why don't we just, I don't know, how would you like to organize this?
I think it's the socialization process itself and the way that that socialization process has perhaps changed in what's really a critical period from about 1850 to the present that perhaps is most interesting here. You can see it in a number of different arenas. You can certainly see it within the disciplines themselves. The socialization process has at the same time broadened and become much narrower in its effects on individuals. The range of possibilities for individuals seems to have constricted within disciplines. In societies, we've had to face terrible limitations on human autonomy, such as fascism, totalitarianism of various sorts in the 20th century, things that were inconceivable in a way in the 19th century. We've had to come to grips with those. We've had to come to grips with the fact that, in part through the application of technical knowledge, we have considerably more freedom in terms of not having to struggle so hard for mere subsistence. And yet, I think there's a general agreement on many people's part that we've squandered the possibilities for autonomy that have been made available to us. I think those are some critical issues that we might want to perhaps discuss a bit more.
So let me just sort this out. It seems to me that if we cut the thing along the line, socialization stroke ideology, then the kind of picture we're going to get is going to be one which is going to be about, I don't know, how should I say this, macro phenomena. We could talk about all these individuals who make a collection in the society, and then there are forces and power elites and this and that to do things to people. If we go back to the way, that's one way of cutting it. Another way of cutting it is reproductively, and that is that people are placed in practices which they transmit through times, like codes and structures work like that. One is to talk about social structure, that's socialization. The other one is to talk about it. Well, I call it culturally, and culturally is to think about it as mechanisms of reproduction so that human beings do things, they act in obedience to things, as part and parcel of what it is to be part of that form of life.
Mm-hmm.
And this seems to me to cut this form process distinction that you've brought up. And I was wondering, can we somehow sort these two things? Can we talk about structure in this social structure sense? This is in terms of ideology. Mm-hmm. And talk about it in, I'm using my language here, talking about it in this depth way, that is, it somehow we're all these transmitters, and as being transmitters, we're trapped in a way. And I think the approach of Foucault and these kinds of people, and I think your own approach is tied to the second one, who wants to produce a theory which can interrelate social structure approach to this deep structure approach. And I, sorry for all the structure, but it's a complicated agenda we've set for ourselves.
To me, this whole issue also concerns the relation between society on the one hand and individual on the other. And to me, society here is by definition utterly conservative, utterly repressive. And that all move, all creativity that comes through individuals, atoms, if you will, misbehaving. Most of that misbehavior, the structure just puts down, abolishes. But some of it becomes truly creative, and in the sense that it survives and slowly changes the structure. Now, what interests me here are the processes through which these small errors that we as individuals do are washed out, and some of them survive. This is, to me, the question of socialization. You can say, you can ask, how do we as individuals become as obedient as we are? You can also ask, how come that society, after all, does accept some very small number of these peculiarities? This, to me, is the socialization. But when we discuss this, or when I think of it, how to be very explicit on the fact that I believe that there is a fundamental contradiction, violent contradiction, between society and individual. Now, these two concepts, of course, are defined in terms of one another, so there is a truly dialectical relationship involved in here. You can then narrow down this question into a whole number. You can say that this is the problematic of the macro and the micro. You can say that it is the question of social forms and individual contents. It's deterministic, stochastic. It's long a parole. So it's visible and it's invisible. So transformations between these concepts that interest.
It seems that that when we get involved, when we find ourselves thinking in terms of these high tensions, you know, we really are. It seems that the vision that is not motivating us, but the vision that's being discovered is something which we might call a tragic vision. Because I'm thinking of Kierkegaard and the concluding unphilosophic postscript, and in that, you see, it's Hegel who he set up as being the system, the big machine that does all the devouring, and Kierkegaard is desperately trying to find a language which would be an adequate language process, which itself would not be systematizing, and it seems that the two of you, in the way in what you're presenting, what you're articulating, seems to embody this struggle, which doesn't guarantee totalizing, which doesn't guarantee integration, and I'm just trying to capture the ethical dimension of the picture that I'm receiving from both of you, actually.
The picture that you are receiving is not a big oil pan painting totalizing the world. The picture that you might be receiving is a collage where each little piece is internally consistent, but where these are placed within this broad canvas as actually a collage. This means that to me the fragment is tremendously interesting, liberating form. So instead of speaking about integration, I rather speak about fragments. And I do that for many reasons. I do it because I think it is more true, but I also do it because I think it is more humane, less totalitarian. And in fact, I have come to think of the concept of integration as a very bad, evil concept. And if there is anything wrong with this particular post-welfare capitalism that we have in Sweden, it is that it has been and that it continues to be too intentional, too goal-directed, too integrated. And I think that we see many, many signs of this now. So I might not be surprised if we were to meet 10 years from now, what we would be talking about would be the concept of intention.
Concept of intention?
Yes. And when we speak about the concept of intention, then we would far more than now speak about politics. Because what is politics if it is not intention?
Well, what I'd like we then have to get to the directionality of the intention, the content of the intention, mm-hmm. and how would you characterize that?
I would not get to the content of intention, because then I think that we might again be misled by the surface features of it. It's the concept of intention itself, which, if you brought up or you touched on tragedy before. And what is tragedy if it is not pursuing an intention long after it has you realize that this intention is wrong, getting you in a dangerous direction?
Is this what happened to geography after the crisis, that it began securing itself? Is this what planning's about too?
This is what planning is about.
Yeah, certainly.
And if Swedish geography is in a big crisis, which I think it is, I think one major reason for that is that it got so fantastically deeply involved in planning. So what was then assumed to be the saving grace of the discipline, I think has now helped to bring it down.
How do you break an intention? I mean, it's really, this is Heidegger's problem. One goes about characterizing a way that one goes about creating and reproducing a world, but it's so deep, you see, that it's like, it's not like giving up a habit like biting one's nails or something. You know, it seems to me that what you are wanting is how do you rechannel something? How does one cease to do something, but one cannot continue to do, but in doing that, one can't go about doing it in the same way that it was created. So how does one cease to do something as an activity?
Well, in a sense, I think your question is wrongly put, because the way that you put that question now is in itself intentional.
Yeah. I've shown what I've yeah. It's fine, I accept the being a guinea pig.
So, in a sense, you are again asking that we replace one intention with another. Now, what I would like us to do, what I think is necessary, is to float a little bit more freely. Not to place such a tremendously high value, for instance, on truth-telling. Now, of course, we should teach our children to tell the truth, and our students to search for the truth. But we should also teach them that sometimes truth-telling is an evil, that it is an insult, that it is very sad.
And to some extent, we've institutionalized, through the socialization process, the values that we place on these things. We tend to be taught that people of principle are superior to those who engage in any form of situational ethics, when in reality, of course, situational ethics can be a saving grace. If you continue to act on principle long after, as Gunnar pointed out, the principle no longer seems to hold, or the evidence of the results of acting on that principle seem to be contrary to the original intention, then you've got the makings of tragedy. And that underwrites, I think, a considerable amount of political behavior in our contemporary society. Situational ethics, of course, can be carried to an extreme as well. An intentionality that shifts constantly allows for no stability, perhaps. But somewhere along that continuum, there is a position that one can take.
Was this issue that several years ago got me deeply interested in logic? Because in conventional logic, what you do is that you start with premises and arrive at conclusions. And the point of this whole derivation, deduction, is to preserve the truth of the premises in the conclusions. So this is a question of truth preservation in conventional reasoning. Now, in practical action, in our lives, that is, of course, not the point. Action is indeed not to preserve what is now true. It is to make what is now true false. What this means, then, is that I think there are a tremendous number of indications that conventional logic does not capture the essence of human action. We don't know what type of logic does it, but that it isn't this, I think, is quite clear. And to me, this is fundamentally related to this issue that I touched on before, that indeed we have not been able to accumulate knowledge in the realm of human action, love, politics. And in my mind, we have not been able to do this because we have been trying to translate the subject matter of human relations into a language which does not suit, whose deep structure is so different from the deep structure of our subject matter of human relations that you constantly make severe translation. You run into severe translation problems. Now, this, we are going in circles, but this brings us back to epistemology again. Because what is it to learn and to know something? Is it not to be able to translate it into another idiom? So when we say that we know something, we do that by comparing one thing with another. In Russell's case, you have a proper name and a definite description. So this means then that knowledge itself is always indirect. Knowledge itself is saying that something is something else. And that then comes back to the whole issue of how we can make identity statements. Because, of course, when we say that something is something else, in a sense we make an identity statement, and in another sense we, of course, don't. Mm-hmm. Because you can just look at this and they are not the same. So the problem here is, again, Russell's and Whitehead's, how you can make statements that are at the same time both true and informative. Now, this issue to me was very, very important from the end of the 60s till the mid 70s. And it almost drove me mad. And the way I got a handle on it was to see that what I needed to understand was a symbol. It was a symbol of the equal sign. You say that something is something else. What is that is? Which is fantastically abstract. And to get any handle on it at all, that is, in my mind, had to be turned into the symbol of these two parallel lines that are in the equal sign. And I don't think I exaggerate that I spent 5 years doing nothing but trying to study that sign.
What did you, what was the, this would be another way of your drawing out a consequence with respect to a crisis. What did you conclude from that?
What I concluded from this was that we cannot do without equal signs, but we can define equal signs in very different ways. And two drastically different ways, represented by conventional logic, conventional reasoning on the one hand, and dialectics on the other. And I often tell one important step in my search here came when, towards the late 60s, I started reading Hegel and Marx again, that I had read in high school, thought I had understood, and now when everyone else was reading it around 68, I thought, well, I ought to do that too. And I read, say, Capital. And I discovered that I didn't understand a word of it. I read again and I read again. And then suddenly I understood what I didn't understand. And that was that Marx's use of the equal sign was drastically different. So I thought that when you read a book and you start off with definitions of a term, you keep that definition throughout your reasoning, no matter what happens to the subject matter that you take. So what you do there is that you hold the words stable, no matter what happens to reality that you write. In dialectics, you do the opposite. You let the words take on their meaning with changes in the subject matter. That's why it's so ridiculously difficult to read Marx. Because as Pareto used to say, Pareto might have made more insightful comments about Marx than anyone else, because he said, I cannot read that man because I cannot understand his words. His words are bat-like words. So when I look at them this way, they are mice. When I look at them this way, they are birds. What are they? So when you read Marx, the word capital, for instance, on page 37 has one meaning, 212 another, 354 a third. Not because Marx was careless, but because he wanted to be so precise that he wanted the concepts to change. He wanted to use words which were ambiguous enough to always be precise. This is another definition, another meaning of equality, identity, existence.
This has a parallel also in what you were saying earlier about fragmentation, looking at fragments, and the fact that through a socialization process, we as individuals, in fact, attempt provisional integrations, constantly trying to make that equal sign be a determined one, and constantly finding ourselves, in fact, unable to do that. One of the things that happens as society intrudes more and more into this process, as socialization continues, as it becomes more and more lockstep socialization, perhaps reaching its peak under a totalitarian regime, is that the number of divergent both and types of equalities mm-hmm. are reduced to either or equalities, in which they become more and more deterministic, and things at the periphery where you said real innovation, real creativity occurs, become increasingly excised. The bounds, in fact, become narrower and narrower, and the ability to include that material which doesn't fit in precisely becomes less and less.
Okay. Here you see that in the equal sign, for instance, you think that equal sign here is a symbol of identity. Something is identical with something else. But it isn't only that. It's also a symbol of existence. Because just as in the issue of personal identity, how do I know that I am I? Well, I know that because I am contained within the same skin, I have the same clothes and all that, physically distinguishable. But that is not all. I know that I am I because I am the only one with my memories. Now this then raises the issue that you can recognize me in my skin and in my clothes, but my memories are different. So there are ontological distinctions between the physical and the mental. And it is here that I see the major distinction between the physical sciences and the human realms that we are talking about. Doesn't mean that I'm saying that physical sciences deal only with physical properties. Does not. But it is easier to think it does.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to, because we're really running for time. Mm-hmm. It seems that there's a... I'm trying to bring together the different dimensions of the discussion that's taken place. And it seems to me that just talking about language, what you're concerned with, or what I guess we all are concerned with, is how does one keep texture open in with language, and when we define things, what mm-hmm. we're demanding necessary and sufficient conditions, and demanding necessary and sufficient conditions, we're thinking about essences. It could be that even with respect to the knowledges that we were using, it doesn't even apply. That kind of demand for structure and cement-like mm-hmm. just doesn't really apply. And yet at the same time we go about doing this. And so the view we have in language when we demand this kind of univocity is integration. Mm-hmm. And so you come along and then the response to that is, how do you punch holes? How do you keep textures open? That's what one's demanding with respect to words, is how do you keep open? So how do you open up language so that there are these gaps, so the process can intervene? This is one thing you're saying. Mm-hmm. And then let me just make one other connection. But the same thing we're saying, that there's something about the character of I don't know, let me call it modernism, mm-hmm. which has secured our world as in terms of the interventions we made, the way we go about organizing the world. This is planning is one activity of that. Which, and this is your reference with respect to socialization, I think, the way you're trying to grasp it that way, and my way of trying to talk in terms of structure, which seems to inhibit it. So you see, it's like the struggle, there's an unequal struggle, historically, in the conjuncture we're in, because it's like we're talking about something which has been suppressed, and which is continually being suppressed. And I don't want to talk about intentions now, but it's like, as if we are trying to say, isn't there, there has to be some way through which openings can be created. Now, whether it was through the FET in 68 or erasures or this or that, the point is that there is this notion that somehow there has to be another way of going about doing things, such that, and that would require, it seems to me, a call for it. It would be a practice of, if you want, recovery. I'm not saying we have a strategy, but it would be an activity which would require recovery.
Recovery is an interesting word that you use, because it has the re in it. And whenever I hear that prefix, I always think back to the mythology of origin. You're searching back to something that is lost. In my mind, it seems to me that we should rather go the other way, should try to create something different. That raises the issue of the practice of how we do this. And here, through my own work in literary criticism and so on, I've been more and more intrigued by what creativity is. And to create is not to have an idea which searches for its form. To create is rather a form that searches its meaning. Which in a sense brings us full circle back into the form content problem again. Because what this means is that when you create, the way that we create as intellectuals is obviously through language, through the texts that we produce. And when I do this, I do it by experimenting with the forms themselves, with the words themselves, from very simple things like misspellings, very simple things like screwing up, if you will, language. You can do that on many different levels. You can do it semantically, and the most difficult thing is to do it syntactically. Why do I say this? Well, whatever I think we say, each one of us will know which the next word will be. So there is ideology, there is taken for granted, sort of emerged in language itself. So if you want to find other ways of picturing, if you will, the world as it is, and thereby recreate something new, and it seems to me that this is an obvious way of doing it. So if in much of my early work I found myself imprisoned in this prison house of language, the phase I have been in for the last 10 years has been experimenting with that language, realizing that you cannot break out of that prison house, but the walls of it, a sort of rubber walls, you can push them a little bit, and the bars in these windows behind which you are contained are not bars, they are bars that you cannot break out of, but you can bend them a little bit, you can lean out and sing, you can put your ear on and hear the birds outside. And you do that by working very, very hard on the words themselves, physically working on them by holding them in your hand.
You can use a whole different series of images as well. In modern art, for instance, one of the reasons that painters like Chagall, Picasso are so effective is because of the juxtapositions which they allow themselves, which they force themselves to make. Those juxtapositions create new ways of experiencing, new ways of seeing. And what it seems you're always doing, whether you're reading Joyce or looking at Chagall's paintings, is trying to, through the medium of those signs that are arranged in such a strange way, break out of the ways of seeing that you've been socialized into. Now, if writing such as yours, Joyce's, or others became general, perhaps the effectiveness would be lost. There have been, in fact, numerous attempts to institutionalize this type of non-logical thinking, this type of breaking out of the prison house of socialization. The Zen koan, for instance, is one such type of mechanism. And I'm sure that after you've heard your 50th or 100th Zen koan, the initial surprise, shock, wonder wears off, and you begin to take that as a new form of normative thinking, a new, in fact, prison house of language or of socialization, perhaps. The thing that I find so puzzling, well, it's not really puzzling, but it is interesting, is the way in which we so carefully exorcise these types of language in our disciplines, not just academic disciplines, but the disciplines of politics, religion, and so forth as well. Mm-hmm. We don't allow ourselves, we have more hatred, more fear, perhaps, of these non-standard ways of expressing things because of the fact that they force us to confront things that we really try to suppress than of almost any other aspect of our academic life.
Raises deep questions about both writing and reading. When I write this particular, very peculiar kind of language that I do now, it's obviously because I want to break out of the conventional mode of thought. And you do that, in my mind, by using, practicing another kind of perhaps even artistic language. At the same time, I obviously would not like anyone else to do it that way. And perhaps there are reasons why I am doing it the way I'm doing, because I want to write it in such a way that it is impossible to imitate. So whereas the majority of my colleagues want to build a school, I would hate to have that happen. And I do everything I can in the formal type of writing not to have that happen, because everyone will realize that it is an imitation. That's one side of this issue that concerns the writing. But I have also found out that it is easier to learn how to write than it is to learn how to read. And this means that I am, in a sense, often a bit sad, not disappointed, a bit sad that most of my readers really illustrate that they don't know how to read. So even with a little thing like a misspelling with a point, 95% won't notice that it's misspelled. Perhaps 3% will see that it is, and they will correct it. 2% will begin to wonder what the point of that misspelling is. So you have to learn to read very, very, very carefully. And perhaps that is one of the major educational tasks that we have, to take the text seriously.
I think you have to be fair, though, to your readers. I mean, yes. One of the problems, of course, is that you're writing in a form that has been highly conventionalized. In other words, you're writing in journals. There's an expectation that there's a type of journalese that will be encountered when reading a journal. Unless you provide a sign that, in fact, you're breaking the bounds, then what is an intentional act on your part will be taken as something that was accidental by the reader. If you're expecting to see, Italian perspective from the 16th century and you get Marc Chagall, you might think that the Marc Chagall painting is simply technically imperfect.
Yeah. I acknowledge this, but you see, what I want to do is something much more difficult than this, because I want also to break the context. I want to write this way in conventional authors, because if I wrote this way in avant-garde journals, it would be conventional.
Exactly, and it would also be dismissible by your colleagues. Yes. And I think that's the critical point.
No, but this is where I'm. I don't know. I will express my confusion. It's it's at the level of abstraction that we're of institutional abstraction that we're expressing the need for violation. So we already are circumscribed. I'm listening to you, both of you, mm-hmm. talk about violation and the need for violation, mm-hmm. and that. My reference system immediately starts floating, and I start setting up my artistic tradition, a tradition in art, mm-hmm. with respect to violation. Mm-hmm. And I won't go through that with you right now as a means of impression. But what I want to do is I want to say, well, we're back to the discipline again. We're back to within a disciplinary matrix, where there are scholarly journals, ways of acting, and also, most important, this comes up to what was said a long time ago, modes of recuperation, modes within which disciplines can recuperate mm-hmm. Esteemed individuals within it for performing the function of being court jesters and fools and all the rest mm-hmm. of it, and also being important symbols of pedagogical for pluralism and pedagogy. I mean, I've witnessed this one witnesses this in philosophy all the time. Mm-hmm. Philosophers go about reading. All of those philosophers who, in fact, are banned from being thought about. We do this characteristic. This is the case of Wittgenstein. It's the case of, it's the case of Nietzsche. It's the case of the whole tradition of philosophy, which we've erased. And all we're really concerned about in philosophy is the obedience to norms. And at the same time, we have our text, and the text are all the philosophers who we were supposed to read, but we can't imitate, that we not can't imitate, mm-hmm. that we in fact cannot absorb. Mm-hmm. So I'm saying that, so it's like it's not the reading of the text per se. It's not learning to violate. It's that we're already caught. The prison walls are very, very circumscribed. We're already caught in very, very intricate practices. When you start thinking about the metaphor structure that motivates you, mm-hmm. it's already caught within, for example, geographical discourse, and so the things that you know about are geographical, as opposed to, all these mm-hmm. the countless other worlds. It could be about the world of canoe making and things like that, mm-hmm. and that's a real crisis that we have, because we're caught within very, very narrow disciplinary practices. Which one's trying to say, it's like accepting this is my fate, but how at the same time does one somehow liberate oneself from it?
I think, first of all, the liberation is going to be a personal one. It's not something that will happen in the aggregate. One certainly wants to influence others, perhaps, to see in a way that is broadly similar to one's own viewpoint, but that I think happens rarely in reality. Much of the work that we do in any discipline, I think, is make work, because we don't really have the creativity to do really good work that's outside the norms. In fact, one of the things that you'd said earlier, perhaps in one of our earlier discussions, was that it's only by going away from the center to the periphery that anything good really gets done. The odd thing in geography about that is that we've defined, for the most part, the periphery in terms of the subject matter. And even when we treat subjects which are supposedly taboo, prostitution, other forms of deviance, things of that sort, we tend to use such a clinical perspective on them. We sanitize them, essentially. We make them apprehensible in our normal positivistic language and worldview. Everything is cause and effect. Everything is aggregate measures. We really don't understand them. We really don't understand why they are, in fact, labeled as deviant by the time that we're done. And we really, therefore, never acquire any self-knowledge about ourselves in relationship to the center-periphery type of question.
Mm-hmm. This table isn't interesting here. It's interesting here. So it's in interfaces mm-hmm. that we do. It is at the limit, as it is on the body, with the skin and the holes in the skin. The holes in our bodies that are interesting, because it is through those holes that we have any contact with the world at all. Here it's interesting then to note how those holes, virtually all of them, are taboo. Begin to wonder why society has had the need to turn the limit, the boundary, to taboo. If that does not have something very deep to do with the repressive, ordering character of society itself, I think it does.
So would you say that the intellectual's task is to is a moral task, which is to point to the holes?
Yes, but if everyone did that, it would, of course, the world would become completely chaotic, dysfunctional.
Well, there aren't that many people who have the capacity to do these things.
And there should not be.
Mm-hmm. But I'm just trying to see. We're back to the ethics question. It seems that the perspective has changed from that of being one's focus on the objective and the theoretical to the task of having a moral practice that is a pointing away to go. You don't have the route, but the point is you can say it's here. Look.
But you don't do this for a purpose. You do it because you don't have character enough to leave it alone.
You don't do it for a purpose.
That's what's wrong with revolutions.
Mm-hmm.
That's why revolutions always fail. Because of their intentionality.
Yeah, well, my response would say, well, how do you, it is, look at it this way. I wasn't saying, look at it this way in order to X. I was saying, look at it this way. Because we're looking at it this way all the time.
Yeah.
And you're starting to say, well, and our conversation is difficult because what the critique is, this is the way it appears. Here are the explanations. If we continue in this route, we will succeed in suppressing ourselves. So we cannot go about saying, no, what we have to do is to have to stop doing this by doing this. This is what you mean by the intention, as I understand it. And what we want to do is, it's like this.
See, most people would say that you should live as you teach. I say exactly the opposite. Teach as you live. It's a fundamentally different attitude to you and the relation between your knowledge and other people. In a sense, you can then say that you fall into the idealist, subjectivist trap. Seems to me to be much more honest to do that.
So ultimately, you can only write about or talk about yourself,
correct,
your own processes of socialization, integration, whatever you want to call it. This raises another question, though. You said earlier that you wouldn't want to found a school. You wouldn't want people to be taught to write the way that you write. Mm. But the question of reading is different.
Yeah.
How do you teach people to read symbolically, non-logically, making the jumps? Can you?
You never teach anything except through example.
Mm-hmm.
So, and if you live something, you have no choice but to perform examples. So you teach through your own performance. You don't perform to teach. And these are issues of attitudes. It's not issues of subject matter. I just came back from a trip to the States, where I met, and I hadn't met them for many years, virtually all of my old PhDs. That was a tremendous experience. Fantastic. And what was so fantastic with it was that all these people were writing about drastically different things. So if you looked at the titles of their articles and books, they wouldn't have anything in common. And yet, it doesn't take more than 2 minutes to see how their way of thinking has been deeply influenced by all the time that we spent together. That was fantastically rewarding, because what that means is that perhaps you actually have had an influence, but not a surface type influence, but one which has helped people to draw independently. But that was not the intention.
Why do we?
Well, thank you both.